Yeah, so in this second video, we are going to talk about the setup, how we can install Python. In the first video, we talked about the introduction, or we talked about interpreted and dynamic programming languages, and C, that C is a statically typed language, and Python is dynamic interpreted. Now let's talk about setting up Python. Yeah, and please watch the video before you install anything on your computer. Watch it at least one time and don't install anything on your computer while you're watching the video, because I will tell you about different approaches for installing Python. And at the end, you will have maybe the full picture of all the options, and then you can just choose the option that is best. But if you install things while you're watching the video for the first time, you may install something that you will regret later on, right? Well, just have some extra work. So maybe just be patient and watch the video first, and then you can install things. So in general, you want to check also maybe before you do anything whether you already have an up-to-date Python version installed on your computer. On a Mac or Linux computer, you can type which Python, and it should show you what where Python is installed and also what version. I think you have to do this in order to find out the details. In Windows, I think you can use the where command, and then you can see where Python installed is installed and stuff like that. And in general, Mac traditionally came with a very old version of Python, Python 2, and we are not going to use Python 2 for this course. So if you have anything that shows Python 2, then I highly recommend you to update this, because Python 2 will likely not be compatible with most of the code that we will be using in that class. Actually, since the beginning of this year, the Python community stopped supporting Python 2 or 2.7. So it's really highly recommended that you upgrade Python. And ideally, I just see I have Python 3.7. Ideally, maybe install 3.8. There's a 3.9 version, which is currently in development. So I wouldn't install that one yet, but 3.8, 3.7 should be fine. In the process of this video or the next video, I will probably also upgrade my Python here to 3.8. I just see it's still 3.7. And let me maybe show you the official way of installing Python first. So the official way is by going to python.org and then downloads. Should be like this. We will check that out. Personally, I usually don't use this installation way. So if we go to the web browser, just entering this one here, you will see this is the main Python website, and I think it automatically detects what operating system you're on based on your browser. Yeah, that's also a little bit creepy because it's like all the privacy stuff nowadays. Anyways, it knows that I'm on macOS, by the way. macOS should be spelled macOS 10, I think, 10 something. That's like a Mac Apple thing that's a little bit outdated to spell it like this, but it doesn't really matter here. I don't want to get distracted. Anyways, you can go here and then download it and then install it. However, I usually recommend installing it a different way, which I will show you shortly. So I personally we don't need that. I personally install Python using Anaconda, or more specifically Miniconda, which is a leaner version of Anaconda. Anaconda comes with a lot of libraries which are useful, but we are not using all of them, and they can maybe use too much storage space on your computer. So I usually use Miniconda, which is just a package installer and a Python distribution. It does not come with any libraries, so I usually prefer that. It's a little bit leaner, but it also requires more work because we have to install packages manually. Yeah, like I just said, Anaconda, Miniconda, these are Python distributions and package managers. Why do I recommend that? It's just like something I had a very positive experience with in the last 5, 6, 7 years. And a lot of the members of the Python scientific computing community is also using Anaconda and Miniconda because the package manager is very nice. So what it does is, for example, it will manage multiple packages for you and making sure that all the required versions are installed. So for example, if you update NumPy, it will also make sure that SciPy, which is connected to it, will be updated and stuff like that. It will kind of see or if you have a NumPy installation, it will require a certain NumPy installation, and it will updating one package will also maybe make sure that the other package is updated. But also if you install packages, it will get you the versions that are best suited, so the newest versions best suited for your operating system and so forth. So there's a lot of making sure that everything works well together stuff happening under the hood. So in that way, I find using Conda very convenient. It will make your life most of the time easier. However, using just a regular Python should also be fine. Personally, it's just my preference using Anaconda and Miniconda. It's also free, so there's not really anything bad about it. In order to show you how we can install it, let me also just remove my current installation. So if you install Miniconda, it will create a folder in your directory and it will contain all your Python stuff. There will be different environments, like I have a Python 2.7, 3.5, 3.8 environment. It's if I want to test different software or want to test how certain code works on old Python versions, I can activate this environment or this environment and just test it. So here I have my 3.8 environment. Here I have an environment for my book, which I worked on. I wanted to make sure that it's tested in a blank environment. So I also have an environment for just for code for my book, testing it and stuff like that. So it's very nice as if you move it out here, it is basically like uninstalled. I can also move it to my trash and then it's uninstalled. There's no stuff left on my operating system, which is, I think, a very clean way of installing it. So the website for downloading Miniconda, it's I've written this down here in front of me. It should be docs.conda.io/ we want the English version, latest, and then miniconda.html. So if we go to that website, we get the different installer options, and you can see there's also some for Windows. We are on a Mac, so I usually use the Bash installer. So I click on that one, download it. So Bash installer means it's a shell script, a Bash shell script. Nowadays, I think since the recent update, what am I on here? That is Catalina. So in Catalina here, I think they use a Z shell by default. It's not a Bash shell, but I think it still works. So I can go to my desktop where I downloaded it. By default, everything downloads on my desktop on my computer. So I have my Miniconda thing here. Make me bigger here. I can then execute Miniconda and then go through the steps. So click enter. I know the license agreement because I installed it many times. All right, so I can scroll through this one. Oops, was a bit too much. I accept the license agreement, and then it will ask me where it wants to be installed. I like it to be in my main home directory, so I will just hit enter, and then it's installing. Yeah, and initializing Conda is also usually a good idea, so I will also hit yes here. And that's it. So I have Conda installed. I can then double check that my default Python version is now the Python in my Miniconda directory. And then I can open Python like this, and it should show me 3.8. If you recall, before that it was like 3.7 something, right? So I successfully updated my Python here. Yeah, what's also nice about Anaconda or Miniconda is that it helps us with managing different environments. So unless you use Python for many other things, you can just ignore virtual environments for this class, but it may be useful for one or the other if you're working on multiple projects to have a statistics 451 environment. There is, by the way, another tool for virtual environments. It's called VirtualEnv, which is also is just an alternative. It's if you go to virtualenv.piper.io, in the English version, stable. If you go to this link here, then you will find about a different environment manager that many people use and recommend. However, personally, I like to use the Conda one. So for example, I can create a new virtual environment just for this class. I can do it like this, Conda create new environment, and then I can give it any name. I will just call it statistics 451, and this will create a new virtual environment. And then I can activate the environment via calling it by its name, conda activate, and then the environment here. And this will have activated my virtual environment. And then I can also deactivate it. This is usually helpful if you are working with various conda packages in different projects, but if you just use Python for this class and nothing else, and you don't have to have different package versions of different libraries, then it's fine to not use virtual environments. Yeah, and how can we then install different packages? So one package, for example, that we will need for that class or for this class next lecture is NumPy. So what you can do is you can use the pip installer to pip install NumPy. However, if you are using Conda, I recommend using the Conda installer. Using pip is just fine, but I usually only use that if a package is not available in Conda. Because the Conda packages, they are usually a little bit more, I would say, better tested. So the Conda community, there's also a Conda Forge community. They have some recipes to making sure that the packages work well on your computer. And historically, for certain packages, it makes it easier to install them. But to be honest, nowadays, there's only a very little difference. But since we are using the Conda package manager anyway, let's just use Conda for installing it. Conda install NumPy. So if we would have wanted to, we could have installed a different version. So if there's some certain version requirement that's maybe not the older, newest version, we could have also installed conda install, let's say, NumPy 1.15. We don't want to do this right now, but let's just say you have a software and you want to make sure your software works for both NumPy 1.15 users and NumPy 1.19 users. So in that way, how I would do it, I would use or create an environment. Let's say conda create new environment and call it NumPy 1.5. Create that environment, conda activate NumPy 1.5, and then conda install NumPy equals 1.15. And then you should see if you open Python and import NumPy as NumPy dot version should be the 1.15 version here. And then if I conda deactivate my environment, I think it has maybe even downgraded Python because it's now 3.79, because it's a very old NumPy version that is maybe not supported in 3.8. So if I conda deactivate it, I'm now in my normal Python thingy here, and then this should be the 1.19 version. Yeah, you can see this is the other version. So I can, for example, if I want to run code in my other environment, I can just activate this environment, and then I will have my other version, and then I can switch again by deactivating this environment. And in that way, I can make multiple environments to test my code in different package versions. And usually for this class, it will not be required. I'm just mentioning it as one cool thing about conda. And later you may want to update certain packages. So you can also use conda for updating packages. It's usually conda update, let's say NumPy. It should tell me, it's actually updating something. Thought it was already up to date. Okay, fair enough. But anyways, yeah, conda update something, it will update packages. And similarly, so if you want to use pip, in pip, updating is a little bit different. So you would type pip numpy upgrade, I think, if you install it via pip. The last thing for this video is maybe showing you how to install packages that are not in conda. So for example, one of the packages we are going to use in this class for certain things is the mlextend package. So the conda install mlextend command will likely not work unless they have done something about it recently. No, you can see it's not working. It's not finding mlextend. So if that's the case, I usually recommend checking out conda forge. So there's a channel called conda forge, and this is a community developed approach or a repository that contains libraries supported by the wider conda community. And conda forge packages are usually very well tested and very well supported on different operating systems. So I really recommend using conda forge over pip, for example. Personally, I'm the developer of mlextend, for example. I usually upload my library to PyPy, which is the Python package index. And once it's there, it can be installed via pip. However, then I also upload it to conda forge, and they run a whole bunch of different scripts, making sure it works on Windows, making sure it works on Linux, on macOS, on different versions. It's way more comprehensive than what I do before I upload it to pip. So usually that version is very well trusted and really robust and should work, basically. So I usually really like conda forge. Let's install mlextend. So yeah, you can see it's also installing some of the requirements, a pandas, matplotlib, and other stuff. So yeah, what's nice about that is we probably won't have to install them by hand later on. Okay, but I think, yeah, that's all I wanted to say about installing Python. I personally recommend conda. However, I realize some people may prefer just installing Python from here, from the main Python website. Either way is fine. I'm just telling you what I am doing, and you don't have to do everything I am doing. I'm just telling you my experience, and hopefully this is useful to you and wasn't too boring. And in the next video, I will tell you about running Python code, what I use for running my code.